There are a lot of I's and U's and we's, but there really is only one set of your DNA. Unless, of course, you're a twin. But what differs you is your name. I first learned the power of a name when I was volunteering at a place that was providing a Thanksgiving feast for the homeless. I greeted the people as they entered the building. I would ask their name, write it on a name tag, and give it to them to place it on their shirt. I saw their faces light up as if it was the first time they had ever had a name tag. This small piece of paper with their name helped them feel like they were no longer a number, but a human being that mattered. Let this be the beginning of the explanation to the power of your name. Have you ever talked to yourself, perhaps out loud? Or have you heard someone talking to their self? We all have dialogue with ourselves, referred to as self-talk. The problem is that most self-talk is negative, and negative self-talk affects our adaptability, resilience, self-esteem, and well-being, and absolutely our ability to make and keep a promise. Let me explain common forms of negative self-talk maybe you can identify with. Filtering. You magnify the negative aspects of the situation and ignore the positive ones. For example, you had a great workout. You completed your long run ahead of time and you were given a compliment about how strong you look. That evening, you focus only on your plan to do even more and forget about the compliments you received. Personalizing. When something bad occurs, you automatically blame yourself. For example, you hear that an evening out with friends is canceled and you just automatically assume that the change of plans is because no one wanted to be around you. Catastrophizing. You automatically anticipate the worst. Let's say you wake up late, you get more red lights than normal on your drive to work, and you automatically think the rest of your week is ruined. Polarizing. You see things only as either good or bad. There is no middle ground. You feel that you have to be perfect or you're a total failure. One example of this is if you do a great job sticking to your meal plan in the morning, but midway through the day you eat something that you've been trying to avoid. Instead of getting back on track that day, you say, "I've already ruined it. I might as well eat what I want the rest of the day." Now that we've reviewed some common forms of negative self-talk, let's talk about some strategies that can help us improve self-talk. I will list 4 strategies for improving self-talk. 1. Use your name. 2. Use a question. 3. Use "I'm having the thought." 4. Don't say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to someone else. So why does saying your name make a difference? Talking to yourself in the third person by using your own name can help you stay calm, cool, and collected without much cognitive effort, according to a new study published in the Journal of Scientific Reports. The results suggest that third-person self-talk is a form of self-control. In this study, participants reflected on feelings elicited by viewing aversive images and recalling negative autobiographical memories using either I or their name while measuring neural activity. In the first-person condition, participants asked themselves, "What am I feeling right now?" In the third-person condition, they asked themselves, "What is the participant's name feeling right now?" Brain imaging results from study 2 show that reflecting on negative experiences using I instead of one's own name is associated with significantly more brain activity. There really is power in saying your name. Authors suggest referring to yourself in the third person leads people to think about themselves more similar to how they think about others. That helps people with some psychological distance from their own experiences, which is useful for regulating emotions. Why should we use a question? Well, according to a study published in the Association for Psychological Science, which looked at participants' word choice of saying "will I" versus "I will," structuring a sentence as a question is enough to motivate goal-directed behavior. Asking yourself about your potential behavior increases likelihood of your behavior. This is similar to open-ended questions used in motivational interviewing in psychotherapy. The idea is to generate thought about accomplishing a goal without being told. Rhetorical questions have been shown to increase persuasion. People are more likely to engage in behavior when they have the intrinsic motivation. So why use the saying, "I'm having the thought that"? By saying "I'm having the thought that" before you complete your thought, this goes back to psychological distancing. Just because you are having the thought doesn't mean that you are actually doing it or can't do it. It's just a thought. Negative thoughts tend to be sweeping all or nothing statements that jump to conclusions. There are certain words that are flags for negative self-talk. By starting your internal sentence with "I'm having the thought that," you can better evaluate and shift it. Strategy number 4, don't say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to someone else. The dialogue we offer ourselves is often the most harsh and critical thoughts we have throughout the day. The negativity seems relentless, yet we believe it without a question. Do you want your friends, parents, or children thinking this way about themselves? Do any of these 4 strategies sound strange? Well, think about this scenario. Tennis player Borg won 5 Wimbledons. His coach Berglund went with him to all major tournaments, planned his meals, organized practice schedules, put him to bed, woke him up, and most importantly, took care of his rackets. Borg was different. He liked his rackets strung at 80 pounds of pressure, which is incredibly tight, almost impossible to achieve without breaking a string or twisting the wooden frame. Guardianship of these high-strung rackets became one of Berglund's most important services. He hoarded them in his hotel room. At night, while Borg slept in peace, he would be woken up by a high-pitched popping noise. A string had snapped. Berglund would get out of bed and sort through the entire batch of rackets until he found the one in which the string broke. Then he would cut out the rest of the string so that the frame didn't warp. Then he would return to bed. What Borg did may seem strange to you and I and the rest of the world, but he and the people he surrounded himself with stayed dedicated to this practice to ensure success on the court. It may have been weird, but it worked. The same goes with keeping your promises. What we do may seem weird to others, but the importance of keeping a promise is more important. The power of your name. The findings suggest that using your name promotes self-distancing and improves your ability to regulate thoughts, feelings, and behavior under social stress. According to Dr. Legg, self-talk is a script that we use to frame our lives. If we engage in positive self-talk, we begin to view the world in a more positive manner and will ultimately feel better about ourselves. We can't always control what happens, but we can control how we react to it. Lastly, let's recap four strategies. Use your name, use a question, use the phrase, "I'm having the thought that," and don't say anything to yourself that you wouldn't say to someone else. What is the power in saying your name? What promises could you make and keep if you practice positive self-talk?